Hi everybody, welcome to this afternoon's webinar on plastics recycling. If you have any questions, please put them in the Q&A box and George will answer them at the end if he has time. If not, then he will contact you after the webinar and answer your query. Over to you, George.
Thanks, Vicky. Thanks for the introduction. Hi everyone, welcome to this webinar focused on plastics recycling. I'm George Theodosopoulos. I'm a senior project leader at TWI's Novel Polymer Technology section. Just to let you know, the slides will be distributed at the end of the webinar, so no need to take notes, no need to rush, just sit back, relax, and try to interact with us and possibly ponder on the concepts we will be touching base on today. To start with introductions, I'm a senior project leader at the Polymer and Composite Technology Group of TWI. TWI, for those that do not know, is one of Europe's largest research and technology organizations. We operate through 5 offices across the UK, but also we have 11 subsidiaries. We have a global presence, as you can see here. Now, we as an organization, besides research and innovation, are also an engineering and consulting firm. We've been offering services to industry for over 70 years. The organization was first established in 1946. We have a large number of members, I think over 600, across an area of diverse topics and fields. And we, besides, of course, research and technology, we are here to serve our members through either certain inquiries they might have, technical difficulties, concerns, or even failure investigations. Now, our members do have some benefits. Consultation, for example, we have dedicated hours for personal inquiries. We can allocate time for one-to-one meetings. And also we provide unlimited access to our technical resources here at our library at TWI. These technical resources are items that you will not find in the public domain. They're the result of core research projects that have been carried out internally here at TWI. And of course, our services range from designing and engineering to process optimization and adaptation, looking into diverse and innovative technologies, selecting the right material for the right purpose. And in case of failure, we can carry out failure investigations. Now, just a few slides on the section where I sit under, the Novel Polymer Technology section. NPT is one of the sections under the Polymer and Composite Technology Group. We have four main themes, four main technical focus areas: polymer joining, polymers coatings and characterization, bespoke training, and of course, plastics recycling and circular economy, which is the theme under which this event is launched. And we will have the opportunity to look at some projects that we're doing here at TWI. Now, these themes, of course, provide services to a large area of industries. We serve the oil and gas, the automotive, aerospace, construction, and very recently, the medical industry. Just briefly on the offerings of polymer joining. In polymer joining, we have experts here that can provide the right solution, the right methodology for the welding process, depending on the final procedure or the final application. And in case of failure or establishing fitness for service, we can offer mechanical testing, defining flaw acceptance criteria, and many other. In addition, we also participate in the standards committees, ensuring that the right practices are applied. Now, on polymer coatings and characterization, we have experts again within the section that have developed a series of different coatings based on application. Some very, very indeed interesting projects, especially if you look at de-icing on airplanes and other applications such as oleophobic and hydrophobic coatings. But within this theme, we also investigate materials, different materials, new materials centered in the market, their characterization, and increasing essentially the durability of a product either through its material adaptation or through the application of a coating or reactive additive. Finally, this bespoke training provides training and certification in a series of in a wide range of areas, primarily on welding and welding based on applications such as medical devices. But this is again an offering that we have been providing for quite some time globally, as you can see here. Now, moving on to plastics recycling and the circular economy, this is the theme under which this webinar is presented. In this technology theme, we look at material selections, essentially materials that will provide a longer duration or the possibility of circularity by design. We determine the service life and potential aging or other impacts following both the shelf life and the product application life of a polymer plastic product. We also are involved in product designing, either to make the product more durable or to apply special characteristics that will allow its either longer use, easy recycling, easy refurbishment, and in general, induce circularity and aid towards transition of that product into a circular economic model. And finally, we provide solutions in end-of-life management, under which plastic management also lies. Now, this is a term that you will be seeing more often, since industry as well do understand that a proper plastic management strategy is necessary to obtain either value products or to obtain reliable products following a circular economic method. Now, to start with the subject of this webinar, I invite you all to take a moment and try to rethink plastics recycling. Think about why we actually consider recycling, what's involved, what are the steps, and how plastic materials are in our lives every day. So if we look at the plastics value chain, we'll see that it covers a very broad field. I mean, plastics are an ubiquitous material. They've been key enablers for innovation, contributing significantly into the development and progress of society. I mean, we could not achieve the innovation and quality of life we have today without the presence of these materials. Now, as you can see, they have a significant footprint in the economy. Just to give you some perspective, the plastics industry has a turnover of over 360 billion euros per year. It gives employment to 1.5 million people in Europe and an equivalent number in the US. So you do understand that it's quite a huge area here. And besides that, it also provides services and secondary employment to some 60,000 SMEs. So it's quite a significant number. In the US alone, plastics is the eighth largest industry. So it is a very important industry. And unfortunately, because of the impact of plastic waste mismanagement, not plastics itself, it has been, I would say, criminalized in some sense and put on the spot as either a product that is unreliable or not environmentally friendly, which is not the case. Now, the plastics value chain can be divided in three main categories. Now, starting with the raw material production, we can see that, for example, 99% of plastics are sourced from oil still to this day. 23 million tons of chemicals are added in the polymer matrix. So besides your polymers, we also add additives, other chemicals, or other additives to either enhance the properties or provide the desired specification. And to this day, even though we're talking about renewable resources, the use of bio alternatives, still less than 1% of the raw materials come from biomass. And of course, you can imagine that even less than that comes from renewable recycled content. So roughly 94% comes from 94% of plastics come from virgin polymers, whether they're derived from biomass or biosourced or from fossil fuels. So there's still a huge gap there, but we'll touch base later on. Moving on to the second category of the value chain, we have manufacturing use. So from the first production of Bakelite back in 1907, marking the beginning of the plastics industry, the growth of the industry did not see this numbers until the 1950s. Essentially, this is after World War II, where plastics did show their potential in the role in substituting at that time bio-based resources and feedstock material. If you can recall, even in the beginning of the plastic era, where Bakelite was introduced, it was considered an item of luxury or something that people must have. I'm sure that those that have one of those old Bakelite phones do value them a lot. And one can see in auctions even pens that were made from Bakelite from that era, the Art Nouveau era, to have a significant value. But it wasn't until the end of World War II where people actually saw the potential. We had major pioneers like Dr. Carruthers from DuPont, where you know all these polyamides and many other materials were introduced, and they completely shaped and changed society and the industry as we know it today. So, as we mentioned earlier, we have a global production to this day of 370 million tons, 55. Approximately of those, a million tons of that is produced in Europe, and we've seen this is increased from 2 million tons in the 1950s to 380 million tons in 2015. This is when we actually saw a peak in plastic production. To provide some figures, some context, 300 million tons is approximately two-thirds of the mass of the world population. So we're talking about quite huge amounts here. Cumulatively, produced, we see around 7,800 million tons from the 1950s until 2015, 50% of which was produced only in the last 13 years. So you can imagine that it is a huge growth in this industry is expected. The global annual demand is estimated to increase by up to 40%. And of course, provided that we don't see any major changes, in technology. If we see other changes in technology, for example, we have electric vehicles, want to make everything lightweight. In the oil and gas industry, we see a transition towards non-metallics, both to tackle corrosion, but also because it makes sense, it's more sustainable, it's cost effective and more environmentally friendly. And in addition to this, if we consider net zero targets that have been put in place, plastics will be definitely an item that we will see an increase in the years to come. So we talked about the plastic production. We can see that since 2016, it has an increasing trend. There was just a slight drop during the pandemic era in 2020, but it shows a slight recovery. Looking at the European figures, we see a steady drop. This is, we can all hope, and this is what data recommend, because Europe is a bit more advanced when it comes to recycling practices. Of course, this varies based on the state. We see, for example, that in the northern countries in the EU, this is actually higher. We see countries like Germany who have embraced this significantly, and we also see the refurbishment of materials. But other states are following. If we look at the demand of plastics by resin, we can see that polypropylene and polyolefins in general have the majority here. Polyethylene actually is the main material of choice. Don't be confused. We have high density and low density polyethylene here, but if we add them together, it's definitely more. The demand is higher than polypropylene. If we look at the demand by percentage here, you can see this. So roughly half of the global demand and European demand, of course, is for polyolefins. Unfortunately, less than half of this of this material is actually recycled. Now, we might ponder for a moment, why is this? This is because, of course, it's a material that is abundant. It is low cost. It's not an expensive product. It's not an expensive material. So we don't have the necessary drive there to see more polyolefins being recycled. To this day, there are some existing technologies out there. However, to provide a quality material, and please hold this, hold the term quality, okay, and a reliable product at the end, we see recycled materials at double the actual price of the virgin material. Of course, as you can imagine, this is not sustainable. One should have the option to go ahead with the virgin material rather than buy something at double the price, which at the end of the day, the consumer will be called to pay. Now, looking at the at plastics by use and demand, we can see that packaging has the majority here, and everyone uses packaging. So we're starting to get an idea of where the problem lies. We mentioned earlier that less than 40% of polyolefins are being recycled, and we do understand that packaging is primarily polyethylene and polypropylene. We'll see, of course, in some cases some polystyrene there, but not much. So we can see that the problem probably lies in municipal plastic waste, but we'll touch on that later on. Now, looking into the final category of the value chain, we have collection, sorting, and end of life. So essentially disposal, end of life treatment. Now, looking into some figures here, we had 29 million tons of plastic waste collected in 2020 in Europe alone. Of course, this is the best case globally of actually recycling or circular turnover. Now, looking at the possible end of life routes, we can either go ahead with recycling and reuse, which is of course the preferred option. However, there are some limitations we will discuss further on. Incineration, landfilling, and of course, it's inevitable, and that's what history has shown. We will, have, of course, always have a small percentage that will be unaccounted for, and we will end up seeing and finding in the ocean or leakage somewhere in the environment. So looking at recycling and reuse, roughly in Europe, 34.6% underwent recycling. So this is seeing a 4% increase from previous years, from 2019. 42% was incinerated for energy recovery. This remained at the same values, no increase here. And 23.4% was sent to landfill. It's a positive sign to see that this decreased, especially during the COVID era, because a lot of that plastic waste that was sent to landfill was actually personal protective masks and other equipment. So even though that is considered, of course, a biohazardous waste and it is sent to landfill, we did not see an increase, and we saw a decrease by 2%. So I want you to take a moment here and consider why we're recycling. So why should we recycle? What's the initiative behind it? Why should we even consider this as an option? Isn't there a better treatment? Why shouldn't we just burn it? Why not somehow recreate naphtha or do something else with it, bury it for a while? Well, there are three reasons that we've identified. So the first are the environmental reasons, okay? Just to give you some perspective, 8.3 billion tons have been produced since the 1950s. 6.3 of which have never been recovered. So they're somewhere in the environment. We know very well where they are. They're in the ocean, of course, the humanity's toilet, I guess. And of course, we nowadays we're concerned about the effects of microplastics. There have been studies out there that suggest that microplastics, especially from polyolefins, should not be of concern. However, it's not just the microplastics. It's the fact that we see this bioaccumulation, that we have plastics now in the food chain. So, of course, there are large quantities in the ocean. Somehow, it goes through the food chain and it ends up to the consumed by humans. So the average person digests somewhere around 5 grams of plastic each week. So it makes you think. And if one considers the issue of persistent organic pollutants or chemicals that are present in those plastics, some of them, of course, are carcinogenic and not safe for the animal or human health, it starts to raise question. And finally, it's, of course, the constant production and replacement of the material lost does add up to greenhouse gas emissions and the subsequent impacts that may have. So when you think about it, every minute we have the equivalent of one garbage truck dumping waste into the ocean. We have to consider that. So that's how inefficient we are today, and something needs to be done for that. The other reason are, of course, financial reasons. Now, this is something that can draw either industries or governments' attention, because up until recently, we were just shipping our waste to other locations and essentially sweeping things under the rug. So let's have a look at some of the financial reasons. Marine plastic waste, as we mentioned earlier, costs around $13 billion per annum. Quite a significant amount. If we look at, for example, if we consider other material alternatives and say we'll get rid of plastic, something better like paper, it degrades, it's good, we know that it works. Any other material alternative will, of course, cause in a best case scenario. Now let's find the best material, the most lightweight. It will cause an increase by 3.6%. in waste, which will translate into an increase of 2.6% in greenhouse gas emissions. Now, as you can see, that's not practical. And furthermore, it will probably be more expensive. So an increase in greenhouse gases and an increase in cost, definitely. Now, the of course, costs on landfill. When you landfill something, it doesn't come for free. Of course, there are management costs. There are long-term concerns. How landfills are built, we don't know whether some renovation needs to take place. And of course, the problem lies into the actual property that makes plastics unique, the fact that they are resistant to degradation. So plastics, even in landfill, will stay for quite some time. In addition to that, there are recent concerns. There should be recent financial concerns with regards to the plastic tax being introduced. Some countries in Europe have already introduced this as a measure to reduce the plastic use, and carbon tax that follows everyone everywhere. So there's no way to avoid this. So there are some financial initiatives, and it's promising to see that the EC also considers the value that is lost. So somewhere between 70 and 100 billion euros are lost in material value every year. So consider that. Our initial investment in these materials, in plastics, are just lost. That is an investment that, through the proper recovery channels and proper sustainability measures, we could reclaim and we could utilize into other more productive areas. So since we mentioned packaging and the fact that it was the biggest percentage of plastics used, 95% of packaging represents the around 25% of the total value of the plastic chain. Out of that, only 5% is being recovered and reclaimed. So not an amazing figure. So final reason to recycle, strategic. So let's look at this long term. If we recycle, what does that provide us? If we're able to reclaim the material that we use, it provides autonomy. It reduces it by reducing our dependency on fossil fuels and raw materials. And we see that nowadays that is important, especially for countries like Europe, where that might be of concern. So we're reducing our dependency on fossil fuel, we're greener, and we're not losing money at the end of the day. So it's, we're talking about a healthy economy, and of course, a return in our initial investment. So this, provided that we develop the appropriate technologies, could lead into further development and a competitive recycling industry. So, of course, to obtain a maximum value and return, we need to enforce a recycling strategy. Without a strategy, we're just randomly moving into directions without having final objectives, or actually not having the right objectives, long-term objectives. So this is clear. I mean, if we look at the recycling rates, both in Europe and the US, the recycling rates remain low. It's slightly better in Europe, but still, in order to achieve the goals that we've set, and there's a very interesting report where I invite you all to read, issued from Google, one of Google's sustainability report. By the way, Google will develop into a major player in the years to come, providing tools that will help towards a more sustainable drive. In that report, we saw that in order to achieve the goals that governments have put in place, we're looking at investments somewhere in between $400 and $500 billion in the next 20 years. Now, 20 years might seem like a sufficient number, but we're talking about $500 billion in order to reach these targets. So it makes you think. We need to start thinking about this seriously. Otherwise, the impacts of this growth in the industry will of course be severe, or could potentially be severe, either in the consumer or the environment. So, what are our initiatives? There are many initiatives, of course, as we mentioned. It's necessary that we have a smart approach, and for this, we have to know what we're dealing with, what is our commodity here, and what is our final objective. And based on the outcome, our available tools, whether it is recycling or sorting techniques, or advanced inventory management, to achieve those objectives. And our target should always be not to have a process that works, but have a process that is cost effective, that can manage high volumes, and is sustainable overall, not just for the environment, but for the economy as well. For example, selling polyethylene and polypropylene at double the virgin material price is not a long last measure, and eventually will affect the economy, since the commodity will be twice the price. So you can imagine that we have to rethink. So we talked about some of the barriers, but in a recent report that was issued from the OECD, it described in a very good way the barriers one may face in recycling. So it's basically everywhere. We can have economical challenges associated with vulnerable markets, for example, for recycled plastics, cost of supplying resin, the whole processing of the material, including sorting mechanizations, the technologies and equipment required there. We have technical challenges, of course, associated with the wide variety of polymers and additives that are used, the lack of proper identification of these materials, the presence of contamination, and so on and so forth. Of course, we have environmental challenges due to the presence of hazardous additives that we mentioned earlier, like persistent organic pollutants or bisphenols. Of course, that are carcinogenic and are a recent concern. And of course, finally, we have regulatory challenges, or non-existent regulatory challenges, or regulatory legislation that is in the wrong direction. And principally, these are associated with illegal waste trade. But these also do pose constraints to existing regulations and eventually lead to uncontrolled practices and not proper waste management. So to understand the actual barrier on the commodity we have here, let's have a look at the polymer. So what is a polymer? So a polymer is a continuation of a monomer linked through covalent bonding. So it's a repetition of a monomeric unit, polymeric. It's the definition by its name. In this case, we see a linear polymer chain with its monomeric units. In this case, we've used polyethylene as an example. Of course, this is an oligomer. It's not even a polymer. But imagine a long chain of this sort. This is, of course, in a best case scenario. In reality, it's nothing like this. We have angles, we have bends, we can talk about toxicity, isotactic, syndiotactic, depending on functional groups, blends, architecture, composition. It's a huge variety that offers exactly that, a variety in properties and resilience. In reality, your polymer is something like this. It's a bundle, and it's characterized by a hydrodynamic volume rather than a length. So it's still okay now, no problems there. Let's assume though for a moment and to understand what polymers are all about, that it's linear. We have a polymer chain here, that's fine, but the polymer chain might have some side chains. Okay, especially in the case of polyethylene, we can have polyethylene chains that are linear, pure, just polyethylene, but we can also have polyethylene that has what we call a co-monomer. We see this in raised temperature polyethylene that offers these extra properties. So as you can understand, even though we have polyethylene in one end and polyethylene in the other, essentially there are different materials. And this, of course, goes into play, and this is why we call polymers as anisotropic materials. They're not isotropic like metals, they're anisotropic, simply because they have this variety. If we top this up with some functional groups that we may add for whatever reason, these can either be additives that are non-covalently bonded or functional groups that are embedded in the monomer through a covalent link. And we can also have functional side chains besides the co-monomer itself. So essentially, we can have a block copolymer or even a random polymer. So essentially, it would be polyethylene, but polyethylene in different varieties. Hence, we have the classification of polymer grades. As you can, if you take a manual or a textbook or even a catalog of one of the resin suppliers, you can see polyethylene in an abundance of different grades. Essentially, those should be treated as different materials. It's not similar to the case of metallics, where you just have the slight presence of another element that offers the extra ability in the alloy. This is something that is embedded in the polymer. It's intrinsic to its polymer chain and cannot be removed. So if you process, for example, polyethylene in one batch, and that's something that's being done today, without taking this into consideration, the fact that even though we're talking about polyethylene, even though the material essentially should be chemically the same, it's significantly different. It's different because its structure may be different, which is translated into different properties. Its composition may be slightly different, again, translated into different properties, or the number of additives may be different, which of course will limit its application. Just to give you an example, food and beverage containers have a restriction on what additives they can contain. This is of course associated to human health and the leaching of these additives. If you recycle a batch that is a random batch and you cannot guarantee the additives, that essentially cannot be recycled or reused for the food and beverage industry. This is an image of what a polymer like polyethylene looks like. It forms these spherulites. And this is in essence the property domains of the polymer. So you have your for semi-crystalline polymers, at least, you have a crystalline domain and the amorphous regions you see in between. These all change depending on side chains, even processing conditions. So as you can see, even though we're talking about the same grade, polyethylene, essentially, it's a whole different world and different material. And I don't even want to go into details on the even smaller the regions of the spherulite where you have the lamella and how that impacts the polymer properties. So if I haven't confused you, and going back into the subject, Let's look at our treatment option. We have landfilling, of course, as an option. We have incineration, as we mentioned earlier, and recycling. To give you some perspective, landfilling, 3-year management plan at the least. That doesn't say that it will not have a buildup of gases, and it doesn't require its further management or maintenance. Incineration, if all else fails, yes, you could reach towards that approach. When we say, of course, incineration, it's not fair. We don't just burn it. It's burned in a controlled manner. You could recover the feedstock, and that's a technology that has been applied widely today. And it is a good resource, provided that you cannot recycle the material. And we will explain further on the energy requirements and best practices why this is. And finally, when we look at recycling, there are 3 main steps, and we have 3 different methods, 3 different options by which we can recycle. So let's look at the strategic factors that we need to have into our mindset before we actually draw a plan on what is the best recycling approach. First of all, we have to consider the waste source. As we mentioned earlier, we have different polymers, different compositions. If we look at municipal waste, consider for a moment what you throw away every day from your household waste in terms of plastic products. You can classify them on your own, and you can roughly see what kind of products you're using, which of them are food and beverage plastics, which of them are not, which of them are from other components or electrical equipment. So this is something that you can do on your own. Then we have to consider the available technology and infrastructure either we have regionally or in our country. And if we want to go into the game of plastic recycling and feedstock recovery, consider what we can afford. Finally, and of course, subsequently, we have to consider what our desired outcome is. And what the future applications and uses of that material are. Of course, this goes in line with the demand that our society has in that region. So it's not just a random let's do everything or let's do it that way approach. It should be more dedicated. And unfortunately, this mentality is something that's following practices from metallics and metallic products. So finally, we have to consider the life cycle of the materials because issues like aging and exposure go into play because they do affect the quality of the material. And finally, we have to consider what are our desired guarantees. Does the recovered material and recycled material have to have any guarantees? What are the requirements there? We briefly mentioned earlier the use of recycled plastics for the food and beverage industry. That's a material requirement. So looking at the energy associated with the different practices, we see here that, of course, banning single-use plastic is a first approach, and yes, it can be done. And we see that we have this change in mentality, especially in Europe. And in some of the states and in the United States, it's not widely applied, but definitely in Europe, we rarely see any plastic bags being used at the supermarket, and we use reusable bags. So that's a good step forward, and everyone has adopted nicely. No major issues there. Unfortunately, though, I must confess that the transition from plastic straws to paper straws is something that I do not agree with, and is definitely not pleasant. But that's a subject for another discussion. This, of course, is the less energy intensive step to just ban plastics, but only in areas where you can reuse another plastic, more durable bag. As we mentioned earlier, if you can recall, any transition to an alternative material source will lead to an increase of greenhouse gases, cost and weight, of course. And then the next step that we should consider based on energy requirements is refurbishment. This is being done, for example, in Germany and in Brazil. We see bottles, PET bottles and containers being returned to be reused. So you have refurbishment there, and it's worked nicely. This could apply in other major appliances, depending the right design is put in place. And you think about its life cycle management in the beginning at the drawing stage. Finally, we have plastics recycling, which is, of course, divided into, you can have either mechanical recycling as a first step and chemical recycling if either you want to improve the properties or you do not have any guarantees on its composition, or for other specific reasons. For example, we're talking about thermoplastics. Of course, our main resort is to either recover the feedstock after a certain number of cycles or based on limitations of the product. For example, the impurities are off the charts. But again, here we have some limitations. For example, some of the items cannot go through thermal anaerobic degradation, pyrolysis, or feedstock recovery if you have, for example, halogenated compounds there or impurities. This affects the process and thus cannot be applied. So you have an idea about the energy requirements now, and moving on to the recycling techniques, which one should we use? Should we use mechanical recycling, chemical recycling, or the combination of these two techniques? Well, it depends on what the outcome is, the desired outcome. Mechanical recycling, of course, is the first step that we should consider. It can manage high volumes at low cost, but unfortunately, without proper sorting methods and inventory management, it does lead to downcycling. And we have mixtures of, even in the best case scenario, of polyethylene and polypropylene, who are equivalent with at least a 3% contamination level. But this can be improved through pre-sorting methods, which we'll discuss later on. Chemical recycling, more expensive, requires controlled volumes, but can lead to upcycling. And it's very interesting, and we will bring some examples. So based on the source, as we discussed earlier in the strategy, we have to consider the different sources, the different areas where waste is generated. So these are household, commercial, and institutional. If one considers these, they can apply the right inventory management methods. Household waste, of course, there is a limited variety of what you will find there. In some cases, it might be, you might see a variation depending mainly on electronics or other products. Commercial, there, again, we see a very controlled variety of materials. And finally, institutional, like take, for example, the medical industry, hospitals. The materials that they use are very, very, they're known and limited. So one can apply the right recovery and recycling technology, especially with materials that are used, like consider a syringe, a plastic syringe. If we set the biohazardous concerns aside, we're talking about an item that had a shelf life of less than a month and a service life of maybe a few minutes. So pristine polymer, I would say, in that case. And of course, we have another source, which is industrial. This is our primary waste, let's say, and it comes from the outcome of manufacturing. And in some cases, when we think about larger industries like the automotive, end of life of the equipment that has been circulated. So what are the main steps? First, have to collect. Collection is key here as well. It will contribute to its contamination process, and then purchasing. So we have to find a market for our commodity. Otherwise, we'll just mix and match, and then it's inevitable that we will downcycle. So by the way, downcycling is reducing the market where we can apply and utilize our recovered materials. And of course, upcycling is increasing the available markets where the materials can be utilized, just by for definition. Now, we mentioned that we have three methods. That's primary mechanical recycling, secondary, which is your, imagine your municipal solid waste, and finally chemical recycling. Advanced sorting. Advanced sorting, of course, is the first approach to increase or increase the value. This can be done by the consumer itself through segregation, waste segregation, as we can see here. You can deposit based on the material, but there are some details that even the consumer does not know. So consider the resin labeling system. It ranges from numbers 1 to 7, where 1 is PET and 7 is every other polymer. What does every other polymer mean? Then you have a definition between low density and high density polyethylene, but there's no discussion on, for example, the additives that are introduced. Is it food and beverage rated or not? So these are things that the consumer needs to become aware, or at least a labeling system that can provide these details needs to be applied and allow the consumer for proper separation if we're talking about waste segregation. Finally, we have automated sorting techniques. These are your everyday sorting techniques. Imagine all these techniques, all the available techniques applied in a linear sorting line. Of course, a single sorting is not the preferred approach. It's best to always segregate beforehand. But even in this case, if you have all the equipment that's out there, all the technologies, essentially you could achieve that high rate and high recovery, high purity outcome, material outcome. Advanced labeling is a major player here. We see, for example, a digital watermarks being introduced that contain essentially as much information as you need and can sort the material from a waste stream very quickly. So it's interesting to see where that will lead. So this is an example of a single stream recycling route, and where everything is added here, depending on what are the contaminants, you can easily remove these contaminants from the layer. But interestingly, as we mentioned earlier, with one of our partners, Filigrade, we're working on introducing digital watermarks for this exact purpose, to add this information into the digital watermark and then source and have a homogeneous material outcome. So add as much details as possible, including, if possible, its use and service life history. So the sorting process and separation technique after this first, let's say, segregation also may include techniques like float sink sorting, flotation, near-infrared sorting, X-ray, laser. All these are necessary depending on the material composition in our waste stream. And this will allow for a better separation. For example, the key advantage of the second sorting method is to separate, for example, PET from PVC, which otherwise would not be possible. Similarly, and this is the reason for this is because of the similar density that the two materials have. You can see in the table here that PET and PVC have similar density. So in a float sink sorting system, they will not be easily separated. We also see some technologies out there that at least advertise that they can sort, for example, polyethylene products from polypropylene products, and quite successfully so, up to 99% purity, but still it does nothing for the different grades of the same material. So mechanical recycling, we mentioned we have primary recycling. It's that waste stream is essentially a pure product. No contamination there. We know where it comes from. We know what it is. Essentially, on the spot, the industries can reclaim the material value and reuse. Of course, depending on the limitations of the material, as we mentioned earlier, we have to consider the sustainability factor of the material. Just to give you some perspective, polyesters like PET can only be recycled for a certain number of time. Regardless of whether you add additives and stabilizers, which of course we expect to leach out. But because of the nature of the polyester, we will see degradation over time, and that's why it's necessary to either replenish or define and set a firm number of cycles, of recycling cycles, after which it has to go for feedstock recovery. So these all need to be considered in a greater techno-economic assessment and a final financial model. So I'm just because of time, I'll quickly scroll through these. You will have the slides, so feel free to look into them. Just very briefly here, mechanical process, I'm sure that you're all aware, initial sorting, grinding, washing, and then final separation and regrinding and granulation later on. Chemical recycling. Now, chemical recycling is an interesting topic. In the sustainability report, again, issued by Google, we became aware that in order to meet the targets, in order to close the plastic circularity gap that is existing and meet the targets that governments have set themselves, besides the huge investments that are required here, we also have to increase mechanical recycling only by 5 to 6 times Whereas chemical recycling needs to increase and improve by 100 to 150 times, so huge increase. So chemical recycling will be a key player in the recovery and of polymer materials and meeting those targets. Today it's used especially for cross-linked polymers, but as chemical recycling here, we're referring to mainly reactive recycling. So we have thermochemical recycling with the uses of catalysts that depolymerize the polymer chain, or at least attack certain cross-links or other regions. The more subtle and more economically viable approaches are, of course, solvolysis, or solvent recovery systems, and we will describe. Now, as we mentioned in the strategy, we have to consider the desired outcome. What is the desired outcome? Do we want to downcycle? Does it matter if we downcycle the product? Do we want to use the material that is reclaimed in a closed loop system in the same application? For example, if you recycle carpet, it will go in and become fibers again for carpet. Is this possible? What are the difficulties? What are the challenges there? It changes based on market, industry, and final application. And finally, what happens when we want to upcycle? Upcycling over there, right there, requires that you remove the chemical history from the polymer. It's not just the chemical history, but also anything that could impact or limit its application into other market applications. So essentially, you have to convert it into virgin polymer, or at least remove some of the limitations, either in the form of additives or in the form of materials that are present in that either blend or product. So looking at the life cycle characteristics, and these are very important that we need to consider. Imagine a plastic product that's been in operation for, let's say, an X amount of time. We need to consider the aging that takes place. So what is the aging? What is the exposure? Is it just physical aging? Is it exposure to only UV and oxygen? Or do we have the case of the presence of other chemicals that have adsorbed onto the polymer? If that goes in a recycling line and is not identified or cannot be separated or prevented, that could contaminate our output. Regardless of whether you have the best sorting methods or sorting mechanisms, in some cases, in some chemical recycling practices, this could be circumvented. You could overcome this limitation simply because you purify and clean and remove the chemical history of the polymer. And we will bring an example that we've developed here at TWI. So one of those examples is isoprep. Isoprep is one of our flagship projects and one of our most mature projects. And I have the honor of being the coordinator in this project. So isoprep is a European funded project. It's led by TWI. It's a consortium of 10 different partners from 5 European countries. And we're focused in this particular case, we're developing a pilot plant system that will allow us to develop any process essentially for any market, any product, any waste stream, apply the right and cost-effective process to recover its full material value. So in this case, we use as our case study carpet waste. Essentially, this is what isoprep is all about in one image. So you have carpet waste and you obtain a very pure powder, completely removing any colorants, additives, all the chemical history that is involved there. And you can also assess issues like chemical aging beforehand during your inventory management and prevent contamination through non-homogeneous products or, for example, waste stream or product sources. So, for example, you can have number or variety of carpet classifications. These are identified beforehand so that the MFI of the polymer is the same throughout the process and the outcome is within certain defined limits that we have put in place. So in a few bullet points, it's an innovative approach. It's cost-effective, it's closed loop. It's a green and circular technology because our plant creates zero waste. Everything is controlled, everything is monitored, and as we mentioned, it successfully removes pigments, additives, and colorants. Now, our objectives, similar to the mindset and the strategy we had before, was of course to reduce the plastic circularity gap. So we have to provide an approach that is viable, that can manage large volumes, and in this case, our pilot plant can manage 1 ton of plastic waste per day. Mind you, this is a pilot plant. This is not a large scale plant, and it will only provide the data necessary to bring this into a larger scale, depending, of course, on the needs and the waste stream, because, of course, requirements may change. And this method leads to product upcycling. In a very quick flow chart, we see that basically the waste carpet goes in, it undergoes an inventory management step. We have size reduction, sink float, density separation, drying, and then the fibers are dissolved, filtered. Of course, this is simplified, and we have the desired virgin quality PP output. In an image, this is what we have. We have a waste stream, segregation, separation. We obtain the PP fibers, which can be used as is if one is not concerned about, for example, additives like flame retardants or colorants. It undergoes our process, and this is the result. Pure white powder, very pure and clean PP granules. To save some time, I'll move on. You can see a very nice example here of some of the fibers that we've obtained through the process. I'll move on to our other innovative project, which is called Solrec. And this is addressing another area of concern and currently a waste stream that cannot be recycled. It is that of multi-layer packaging. Similar to the previous one, this is an EU-funded project, and it's focused, it's a similar situation. You use chemical recycling, but chemical recycling dedicated on a specific purpose and desired outcome. So in this case, we have a pharmaceutical blister packaging, as you see here, or multi-layer packaging, which cannot be recycled. And essentially, we're using a toolbox of solvents and treatment methods to separate the layers, to laminate the layers, and reclaim the material value. So again, an innovative approach for a waste stream that currently is sent to landfill and cannot be managed. And this flowchart essentially shows the overall route of the method, starting through advanced sorting. This is where our partners, where digital watermarks go into play to increase also the speed and efficiency of initial inventory. Finally, we apply a solvent toolbox that leads to layer separation and reclamation, and final labeling, also adding the information and the processing history that has undergone. In this case, it is a first, let's say, recycling step. So the number of cycles that the material feedstock that is reintroduced should be marked here. Now, to conclude, I'd like to mention that for any inquiries that you may have, or for the questions that will not be able to be answered at this stage, you can contact us at any time for any questions, or to collaborate through the contact details here. As I mentioned earlier, the slides will be circulated. I want to close with a phrase from George Bernard Shaw, and I think you'll find interesting. I call you to join me in changing your mindset. So, don't consider something, don't see a different approach and ask why. Instead of it, embrace it and say, why not? Why not be disruptive? Why not be innovative? Why not let us do things differently? Let us not wait until financial drives leads industry or markets to take approaches that at the end the consumer will have to pay for, but rather let's take a step forward and go for practical choices that have higher returns. For example, we have the plastic tax that's being introduced, especially in the UK, which dictates that we have to have at least 30% content in our material to avoid paying Is that the right approach? Well, it is a driving force for people to change their existing practices. However, instead of accepting the 30% limit, why not go for 100%? And I'll tell you why. The 30% limit is basically the upper limit where a contaminated or a non-homogeneous polymer reclaimed feedstock can be added into a matrix without causing any major issues. So again, the inventory management, output, and proper proper sorting and documentation and recording of the material's life cycle is key here. You have to know how many times it's been processed, what's in there, to define and know what its final application is. And I've gone 2 minutes over. I apologize for this, but with that, we can quickly start the Q&A session, starting with a question from Jay. I recycle PET bottles. How can you help me here? Well, PET is an interesting area. We can help you in any way you see fit. Sky's the limit. We can discuss new designs on even how to remove different polymer types. For example, PET bottles, of course, have a polyethylene cap. And in some cases, that nasty ring remains once you open the bottle. Isn't that something that we need to consider? Also, what are the limitations in refurbishment? The first limitation is its design. If you want something to be appealing from a marketing perspective, one must consider either a scratch resistant or indentation resistant layer, or refurbishment through other methods like polishing, let's say. But of course, that adds up to the cost. Those are just a few methods or approaches that come to mind. But please feel free to contact me. We can have a one-to-one on this. What about plastic to oil? This is a question from Alireza. Plastic to oil, which is a progressive technology and many companies are working on it. So plastic to oil is a technology. It is progressive, but not that progressive. So plastic to oil is what I was referring to in the beginning. Essentially, you're taking your plastic material. It is it's considered a recycling technique, but it's not the recycling technique. You don't recover the polymer. You recover the feedstock. So it's feedstock recovery rather than polymer recovery. So you go back a step, rather than trying to keep that energy requirement. If you recall, let me bring up this slide to the screen. If you recall this flow chart here that takes into account the energy involved, of course, this requires higher, comes to a higher energy cost. In this case, and that's why we have, for example, pure virgin polyethylene derived from this. There's no doubt about that. It's as pure as it can get, but it comes at double the price because as a result of these process. Another comment from Stefan. These numbers do not include textile applications. Yes, this is not a textile specific, webinar. This is more of gives a spherical overview. However, textiles is something that we are working with. For example, in isoprep, it's a special area, and nonwoven. That's definitely an area that we have looked into. For example, face masks. The same strategies apply there. The limitations may be different. The final strategy might be slightly different, but if one goes through that thought process, always consider the energy involved, the desired outcome, and the resources they have, they can achieve the desired outcome. Just to give you some perspective, in the isoprep process, of course, you can define and tweak the amount of energy that is spent through processing, effort that is spent through processing to achieve this obtained result. Now, the limitation when it comes to textiles is what technique will you apply through that continuous process? Does it first need to be granulated? Does it first need to be separated and then processed? Or can you do it in a continuous flow? Our experiments suggest that doing this through a continuous flow does have some issues when it comes to textiles. And of course, other limitations are bound by the material itself. It's more difficult when you apply this on polyesters than polyolefins. Question from Anna Lucia. Could the sorting techniques described for microplastics be applicable in same efficiency for microplastics? Microplastics, well, that's an interesting question. Microplastics, the problem with microplastics is that you cannot, in some cases, you cannot even identify them. They're leaked into the environment. You might, in some cases, see colors. I'm sure you've all seen these devastating images of seagulls where you open them up and they're full of plastics. Microplastics are a result of friction and time. When we're talking about polyolefins again, nothing happens, at least nothing significant happens to the polymer itself within the first 10 years. However, it is still a microplastic. You can apply the same recycling techniques, like, for example, if you don't know if you can gather them, first of all, and I assume that that's going to be quite expensive. So I would rather recommend we avoid the creation of microplastics because, of course, it's something that you cannot easily control. And it will come at a significant cost. You could essentially apply mechanical recycling, but then again, this is a source, a waste stream, where you have no control over the material grades, additives that have been introduced. Analyzing also is a nightmare. But there are solutions on how you can obtain higher value there. For example, reactive recycling. These are modifications that you make on the polymer chain for a desired material property and outcome. So another question from Amy. Would the cost of recycled plastic material be offset in the future by increasing cost of carbon credits for those business requiring carbon neutrality? That's highly possible. The trend nowadays is just tax, increase. Governments get extra revenue. The problem is, of course, not solved. And we, the people, the taxpayer at the end, ends up paying the price. So we have to change our approach on how things are done. We should take advantage of the recent plastic taxes and other financial, let's call them drives at this stage to improve our operations. Final question from Vincent, would you consider oxo-biodegradation to limit impact that leak out of the recycling stream? Well, I assume that you're referring to this in a way to completely degrade the polymer. Yes, this is a method that has been applied. So there are polymers out there that are biodegradable, and they're biodegradable in a control manner. So you actually know the time limit, you know when it's going to be degraded, and you can also control the outcome. In some cases, there are industries that the outcome, the degrade polymer is a fertilizer. So there are technologies out there, but again, that is not, in my opinion, the recommended approach, because there is value lost there. So the commodity, what went through, all the effort, all that energy to produce that product becomes, yes, it might one might advocate that it becomes a fertilizer, but we have to control that as well, because otherwise it will cause other issues when it comes to its accumulation. I mean, consider the huge volumes and large amounts of plastics that we expect will be generated and will be out there. So it is a method if everything else fails, but I'd rather go with controlled approaches. If we reach a limit by which it cannot be recovered, the plastic cannot be reused, the best approach there is recovery sessions where we have feedstock recovery, essentially, what our friend mentioned earlier on plastic to oil, if, again, that is possible. If it's not possible, unfortunately, well, we have landfills, and we at TWI, at least, we're pondering on some advanced, let's say, biodegradation techniques using genetically modified enzymes. So somehow try to bury it, but also process it at the same time. So instead of just throwing it in a landfill, we also process it. So that concludes the Q&A. I hope you enjoyed this this webinar and the Q&A session. Stay tuned for subsequent webinars on the subject. In the webinars that will follow, we will be focusing more on the details around mechanical recycling, how you can improve value, chemical recycling. We will go into more details on isoprep and isoprep's capabilities, as well as other recycling techniques. We will also discuss pyrolysis, how to prepare your business against this plastic tax, plastic management practices, and other methods. In the meantime, if you're interested, please follow us on Twitter, LinkedIn, and join us, or even inquire on becoming a member. We're always open for new members, and I'm sure that you can obtain value. So I hope you enjoyed. Have a nice remaining of the day. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you, George. That was a great presentation. And thank you, everybody, for attending.